Now I want to talk about women artists in classical antiquity. Now, if you've taken my survey course, you know that when I say classical, we're talking about ancient Greece and Rome. And frankly, we don't really have any survivals of women artists' work that we know of. You know, we have mostly vase paintings and a few paintings from Pompeii and Herculaneum. But we have, you know, no record of who painted. But what I want to do is go into some of the evidence of women artists in classical antiquity. Now, according to a story told by Pliny, painting was invented by a woman, the Corinthian maid, who traced the shadow thrown on the wall by her sleeping lover's profile. Now, where do we get this source? Who's Pliny? Pliny the Elder, first century Roman, from whom we get a lot of our information about Greek and Roman art. And then the story is retold by Athenagoras in the second century AD. Athenagoras names the woman, the first painter, Kore, which is the Greek word for young woman or maiden. So sometimes she's called the Corinthian maid, sometimes she's called Kora, and sometimes she's called Diputade, the daughter of Butade, and Butade is her father. So the origin of painting is that this young woman traces her lover's profile, and then her father invents sculpture because he builds up a ceramic relief in clay on the basis of her painting. Once again, we assume that women were involved with things like textile workers. Certainly all of our Greek, all of our information about Greek Greek myth, Greek stories, they seem to think that a very important thing that women do, of course, is to spin and to weave. And that, think of Persephone, you know, every day weaving her tapestry and then tearing it out every night until Odysseus comes home. We don't have, as far as I know, we don't have these ancient Greek textiles to show you. We do have, of course, Greek pottery, and here's a very early Greek example of a Greek geometric vase showing, and you can see in the detail, a funeral procession with the women mourning, little women here, all very stylized, all very abstract, but it has even been suggested that some of these geometric patterns may be related to textile art. We certainly know that the women were supposed to be able to weave stories into their textiles. You can think of the story of Arachne and Athena, that is, we find in Ovid, where one of the great weavers challenges the goddess Athena, the goddess Minerva, to a contest, and of course, the goddess wins, and changes the poor weaver into a spider. It's where we get the word arachnid from. Certainly women were creating what you can call it craft, you can also call it art in textiles. There also are six women painters mentioned in Pliny's natural history. And so I listed them here, at least some of them, and you will find in many different books when you look at them, the names get changed. They seem to alter through time. Sometimes they're confused with other names. But you can see the list here. I'll mention a few of them. Aristate, who may become Irene or Irene, who is the daughter of a painter. Timarete, who is sometimes called Tamar or Tamaris, and is sometimes confused with the queen Tamaris, but I'll explain that to you in a minute. Timarete is supposed to have painted a famous painting of Diana of Ephesus, and Helen of Egypt, who's supposed to have painted a famous painting of the Battle of Issus when Alexander defeats the Persian Emperor Darius. Well, what do we have here? We have a mosaic from Pompeii, and it shows Alexander defeating Darius, and here you see the detail showing Alexander, and of course the overall mosaic has some sections that are lost. Now, one of the questions is, could this mosaic copy a lost painting? And some people have suggested that it copied Philoxenes' painting, other people, who was a male artist. Other people have suggested perhaps it copies Helen of Egypt's famous painting. There's no way for us to tell. There's no way for us to tell whether it copies either of them. but it's a possibility. There are other women artists who are mentioned, and plenty. Olympia, nothing's really said about her. Calypso, not much known about her. And Ia, I'm not sure how you pronounce her name, Ia, of Kazikos. Now, her name starts to change. That I becomes L, and you see her sometimes called Leia or Lala, various spellings. But she's someone that Pliny talks about her and gives us a little information that she was a Roman painter of the first century BCE, that she was famous for painting her portraits of women, that she's said to have had amazing speed in creating her work, and that she outranked her male competitors. And also, and we're going to see how this gets interpreted in a later period, she remained perpetually virgin. So she's certainly one of the examples of a woman who had to choose between marriage and a career, evidently. Now, I found this picture in a book, and it said that it was Marcia, who is sometimes considered to be a later renaming of Ia. The source that I got it in said it was from Herculaneum. I then found it on the web in color, so that's what I'm showing you, and that one said it was from Pompeii, so I am not sure where this is from. But one of my books said that this was a woman artist. However, when I found it on the web, they said nothing about it being a woman artist or being Marcia. And I don't know whether you would normally have a picture of a woman artist exposing one breast. So I'll just put that in as a possible visual image, but I have some suspicions about it. Where do we also see women artists from classical times depicted? Well, Boccaccio. Boccaccio is a very, very famous Italian 14th century writer. He's said to be the first novelist. He also wrote one of the first mythology books for the Renaissance on the genealogy of the gods. And he was a humanist scholar, which means that he was reading classical sources. I don't think he read Greek, so he's reading them in Latin, and he's reading Pliny. So he's heard all these names of the women artists. First he writes a book concerning famous men, and then he writes a book concerning famous women. And among the famous women are these famous women artists from classical antiquity. And by this time the names get a little bit changed around. Boccaccio's books were very popular. They would be copied, they were in Latin, so they could be copied in many different countries. And so we see manuscript illuminations, including manuscript illuminations that are supposed to be pictures of these women artists. And we see here this picture of a woman artist from a manuscript copy of Boccaccio's concerning famous women. And you can see that she is painting while she has a male assistant grinding the paints for her. I might point out it looks like she's painting Madonna and Child, which we would say, oh, that's quite an anachronism. But in the 14th century, they really weren't considering the anachronism of it. I'm particularly fond of these. These are from a woodcut version of Boccaccio. And you can see what has happened. Marcia, and here we see her painting. It looks like a portrait of a queen, perhaps. And she is painting, and she's dressed as a nun. Remember, Marcia, was perpetually virgin. And so what he's done is take that information. He's changed her name to Marcia. And, you say she's perpetually virgin. The medieval interpretation is that she must have been a nun. And so we see her and her sculptor friend over here in the next panel. Voronius is a female sculptor, and she's also shown as a nun. Another reason for that may have been because in earlier times, in the Middle Ages, the women artists were generally nuns. So here we see her, the picture we showed you before of Marcia, Iaia, who was supposed to have painted mostly women, and she's painting there. She is known for her chaste modesty because she was perpetually virgin, and she surpassed the famous male artists. So here we're seeing 14th and 15th century manuscript images with Marcia painting a virgin and child. That is an anachronism. And we're seeing her male assistant grinding the pigments. Obviously, a pre-Christian artist would not be painting Mary and the baby Jesus. And we see our male assistant grinding the pigments. you see that they're shown in the context of their time. And we probably can find out a little bit about how artists in the 15th century painted by looking at these pictures. Because we can see here Marcia, who's painting her self-portrait. And can you see at one side, there's this round image? That's a mirror. In the 15th century, mirrors were convex and round. So she's looking at herself in the mirror, and then she is painting herself in the frame. On the other side, she's got an easel where she stands at it, and she's looking at herself in the mirror. In fact, we can see the reflection painted in the round mirror, and then she is painting herself. This I have seen both called Marcius and called Tamar, Tamaris, Tamarete, Tamar, all the variations on the name, painting her self-portrait.